our praise team turned into shorty today. They put it back. Let me share it. Look, there was the heart of our music program for a long, long time. Keep grabbing that piano today. We appreciate Miss Jackie just helping us the whole she can. That was the heart of our music program.
Amen.
She took off tomorrow. Thank God she comes back to see about us every now and then.
Yeah.
But if you'd like to stand as we sing, I give us some words. The king is coming looking in three tries to get it right. We're going to do this three tries, okay?
Coming soon here in a few moments, because that's the title of our sermon today. We're talking about Jesus is coming, and Jesus is coming soon. We welcome you. Miss Sharon, good to have you back. Yeah, you can say something. Say it big and loud. Brand new repairs on that old ticker of hers, and I think her daughter said they're going to turn her loose next week and let her drive again. So watch out, she'll be ready. But we welcome you. If you're our guest, we welcome you. If you're here for the first time, we're glad you're here. If you're coming back to see us, we're very happy that you're back to see us today. So we're glad that you turned aside to be at Green Pond this morning. And Miss Sharon, we're glad you're here. We know it was about 8 years ago that Brother Tom left us and went to his home in heaven. And we appreciate you all so very much and your service and stuff to the church. We know she's about like Brother Bert. Green Pond is just home. And has that great, great love for Green Pond. We're so glad and appreciative for that. I know Miss Jackie's happy today.
Amen.
So, you know, so thank you. Thank you, Miss Sharon, for being with us today. We remember Brother Tom and remember all your great service and continued service to the church. We appreciate that so very much. Look at the opportunities. A lot of things will be happening this week. Of course, you all probably know by now that Miss Rosalie Grimes passed away, And we'll be having her service here tomorrow. And 12 o'clock is the visitation. 1 o'clock is the funeral service. And then afterwards there will be a meal. And I know maybe some of you have been contacted about fixing or bringing things for that. So just kind of remember that tomorrow, a special celebration of life for Miss Rosa Lee. She came to our church here in 1987, moved her letter here, and been very faithful over all those many, many years of service. So we love her and love her family, and look forward to a celebration tomorrow to remember her life and to celebrate what she has left for her family, great heritage and things for them. Kind of a busy week for us. Also tomorrow night, guys, we're back on track for our men's MEAT night, men's meet night. And we'll be meeting at 6 o'clock, should be ready to eat by about 6:30, maybe somewhere in that ballpark. If you remember how that goes, you just bring any type of meat that you want Brother Paul to put on the grill and season it up good for you. Just any kind. You can bring anything from, I guess you can bring anything from squirrel. We had somebody bring squirrel one time. You could bring squirrel, you could bring fish, you could bring steak, you bring hamburger, whatever you want to go on that grill, they'll throw it on there for you. And then if you'd like to bring a side dish, that'll be okay too. But we're getting that back together. We always had a good time of fellowship together, so remember that, guys. Tomorrow night, and then next Saturday, kind of a big day, the children's Valentine's celebration. That is at 11. Is that 11 o'clock? 11 o'clock. So y'all going to have a great day together. So you be sure to come and be a part of that. Miss Sherry, she's been working on that. We're going to have a great day for you. So remember that. Bring your kids, grandkids, get the word out. And then next Saturday night is our adult, this is an adult-only type thing, our adult Valentine's social. And it's not a couple social, it's an adult Valentine's social. So it's for any of our adults. If you'd like to join us, sign up back there so we kind of know how many is coming. We prepare everything for you. We have a great night. We're going to be seeing I Still Believe or something like that. Great movie, kind of fitting for Valentine's Day. We'll have that for our movie for the evening. We'll have popcorn and we'll have hot dogs and we'll have movie candy and drinks. We'll have all that, just like you're going to the movies. And we'll provide all that for you. And we'll have those that'll be serving you. All you got to do is come and sit down and have a. So if you want a good date night, that works too. If you want to do something, if you're kind of cheap, and that would be okay. Valentine's is just around the corner, so that would be a good thing. You come, you're not out of nothing. Just maybe the gas to get here. So hey, that's good. That was just something I wanted to send to the guys. Kind of just send that to you. Let you pick up on that, and I hope you picked up on that. That'll help you out a lot there, I'm sure. But remember these opportunities to serve. Next Saturday, our bereavement group meeting, just a busy day next Saturday. A lot of things happening and going on. Keep these things in your prayers, if you would. Let's pray together. Father, we are grateful for today. Today is the day that you have made. This is your day. We're glad, Father, when you said unto us, let us go into the house of the Lord. I remind myself sometimes, I think about, is it Sunday yet? Is it Sunday yet? And not because, Father, of my obligation, but because, Father, of my love for these times together. That, Father, we could even say in our heart, like the psalmist, like David, that we're excited that, Lord, it's Sunday again. And it's time for us to come and together and to worship together. Lift up the mighty, powerful, wonderful name of Jesus. Father, we're excited to do that today, and we're grateful, Father, for this time. Thank you for each one that's come this way, every home, each heart, each life, each family. And we're so grateful, Father, for the many wonderful blessings you bestow upon us daily. And Lord, we lift those to you today that cannot be with us. We know, Father, we always have on these days, Father, folks that are committed to their jobs or places, Father, of service. We know we have those that are sick and afflicted. We know we have those, Father, that are bereaved. And Father, we sure have several of those today. Families that we can think of that's dealing with sickness and trials and, Father, heartaches. And we just bring them before you today. Thank you, Father, for this time. And we thank you, Father, for the memories of loved ones like Brother Tom and others, Father, that we don't forget. And Lord, you don't want us to forget. You want us to remember those. Father, we have stood on the shoulders of mighty folks of faith. And we need to remember that, Father, throughout our lives and throughout our times. Why are we here today? What gives us the privilege to be here today? Father, it's the service of many that have gone on before us. They have been faithful. And Lord, like Miss Rosa Lee, Father, they've been faithful. And Father, we're just grateful for that. And we're thankful, Father, to be, Father, in your presence today. We pray, Father, that we can be found faithful. Lord, we got two things that's coming at us pretty quick. And Father, that's either the physical death itself or Jesus returning. And either one of those is coming at us quick. And Father, I pray that we're ready today to meet our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. Because Father, you could come at any moment, at any time. And we look forward again, like looking forward to these Sunday services. Father, we look forward to the day. Maybe as the Apostle Paul, he wanted so much for you to come while he was living. Father, we want so much for you to come while we're living that we don't have to face the physical death. But Father, we would be caught up with you right away. Lord, whatever it is, whatever your time is, we know it's in your time. And Lord, we look forward to that day. But Father, we do, Father, have those loved ones that, Lord, we care about and we love so desperately that we'd love to see come to Jesus. Lord, go with us. Bless us in this time today. We pray in Jesus' name. Amen.
I guess I ought not to say this, but I was thinking it, so I done thought it. So I was thinking the preacher might be giving that pitch about the Valentine's party on next Saturday night. I thought he might be kin to Hank Williams. Amen. He'd come up with them songs. Well, if you got the money, honey, I got the time. He's talking about that line. I got a hot rod Ford and a $2 bill. I know a spot right over the hill where it's going to be, right here. That's where you can come honky-tonking next Saturday night, I guess. But we're trying a different thing. We didn't have time to practice on ourselves, so we're practicing together. We're trying to take this one of these. We used to sing this, Jesus is Coming Soon. We're trying to turn it into a hymn instead of like a special music part with the parts. We got a type that we'll see what happens, and we'll make a stab at it. If we fail, we'll stop and start over, whatever. But Jesus is coming soon. Okay, let's see what happens. Give you a few words.
Jesus, come in.
got a wonderful, he's coming soon. One of these days, you don't know. Do we? You ready for some special music?
Shorty, we got a delay. Caitlin ran into some bad traffic. Can we give her 5 more minutes?
I can do some children's message.
Yeah.
Oh, we'll see what happens.
Okay?
Yeah.
Well, children, you all come on down and join us. We'll get you all ready to go to children's church this morning. Any others back there hiding somewhere? Where you hiding at? Like the little boy, here's the story about that. I don't want you all doing this, but the little boy, he was sitting beside this elderly lady. And the offering was coming down the aisle. Remember when we used to take the offering? Remember that? Well, we had to think about it. Remember when we took the offering? The offering used to come down the aisle. But I didn't know if I'd ever say that in my ministry. Remember when we used to take the offering? Well, offering was coming down the aisle, and she was fidgeting, and she was going through her purse, and she was looking and scratching and looking, and she was trying to find her money, and boy, she's getting all excited because the offering plate was getting close. The little boy, he reached over, and he punched her, and he said, "Here, lady, take my dime. I can hide under the pew." So you guys might be hiding under the pew back there, a little brave, but we're glad you got it. Y'all have a good week?
Sir.
Pretty good week? Okay. Well, good. We're good. I did not know they made habit shirts that small. That is great. I just looked down there. I saw he had a habit shirt on, and I love those shirts.
Yeah.
I would wear them every day, all the time. I think I'm gonna tell my wife when she buries me to bury me in one of them habit shirts. She can pick the color, because I got about 25 of them. Well, I can quit stage in time. I saw her pull in. Well, guys, we're going to talk about this morning. Jesus is coming soon. And I don't know if you know exactly what that means. We call it a second coming. And the reason we call it Jesus' second coming is because, remember what we celebrate at Christmas? When do we celebrate at Christmas?
Jesus' birthday.
Jesus' birth, that's right. And that's when he came the first time to earth. And so now when he said, "I'm going to come back," he left. Remember, he left and he went back to heaven to be with his Father. And he told his disciples in John's Gospel, in Matthew's Gospel, in other places, that he would come back, that he would come back. And this we refer to as his second coming because of his first coming. This would be number two. And so we call it a second coming. But Jesus will return, but he will not come back as just a man, and he will not come back as a baby being born. He will come back as a king, and he'll come back in all power. You know, the Bible even says, I know you guys are like this, the Bible even says he'd be riding a big old horse. There'd be a big old horse. I mean, some of you love horses. Think about that. And think about Jesus coming back. And that shows victory. That shows when the warriors and those who go into battle back in those days, of course, they rode horses. Today, we drive tanks and have other vehicles, you know, to drive into battle, but they rode horses, so that showed power, that showed might, that they would come and have a mighty army, and Jesus will come back, and the Bible says, even John said, "Even so come Lord Jesus," he said he would come quickly. The time, I can't tell you. Somebody say, "Preacher, when do you think Jesus is coming back?" I don't know. The time, I can't tell you when he's coming back. Nobody really knows when he's coming back. All we know is that he said he's coming back. And we think that, you know, with everything going on today, that it could be very soon. But you don't have to worry about it. Because that'll be a great day. That'll be a great day when the Lord returns. That won't be a sad day. Not for us. Not for you. That'll be a great day when he comes. We don't know when that's happening, but we just know he said he was coming back. Don't you love it when your mom or dad or you go off to school and you give them a kiss and sometimes you tell them, I'll see you this afternoon, right? I'll see you this afternoon. I'll be back. Or they'll say, I'll be back to get you. Aren't you happy that they come back and get you? That's pretty neat, isn't it? Well, Jesus will come back and get us. Father, thank you for these children this morning. We pray your blessings upon them. And help us all, Father, with just the childlike faith to just believe you and trust you that you're going to do what you said you'd do and not be all concerned all the time about all the details, but, Father, just to have our hearts ready and be prepared. In Jesus' name, amen.
You know, I hate to think, I see Christians walking around with faces down here, and I can't think of why. I'm so excited about God coming back. I don't like where we live. I don't like what we're experiencing in our government, in our lives. And I love to see happy smiles. And you know what? What turned me on was when you said, he's coming back in power and might. And I'm excited because I'm going to be moving to a better place. And that's what I want. I want you to smile. I want you to feel that.
A mission, faith, and hope, and love. I got more than my share. I'm moving to a mansion just over in glory. I'm a rightful heir.
Well, let's have a little prayer and go amen here and move right along. Wow, thank you, ladies, so very, very much. Turn with your Bibles this morning to Matthew chapter 24. Matthew chapter 24, we're going to look at verse 27, drop down to verse 36, and right on down to verse 44 will be our text. The Lord, I got a big old box that sits behind my desk, and I've probably got easily 500, 600 handwritten old typewriter. Do you remember the typewriters? Old typewriter written sermons that go back all the way back to about 1979, somewhere around there. And I go through that box every now and then. I get it and I go through it and I sort out, and I'm thinking, you know, all those sermons, 500, 600 sermons, I've kept every sermon I've ever preached, and I've wrote down every sermon I've ever preached. First sermon I ever done, I scratched it out with my hand, I scratched it out on some paper, and that's what I had. Later on, boy, the typewriter, I got a typewriter, I got a church that had a nice typewriter. They even had one of them electric ones. Remember the ball? The ball. Watch that ball. And then got real fancy. I got one that would correct itself. You could hit it and go back and it would correct itself. And boy, that was neat. And then eventually computers came along and, you know, we got those fancy things that you can just do anything and everything on those. So I've got them all the way back from hen scratching to modern computerized, typed out every sermon probably in 40 years. And I found a sermon from 1988. And why is 1988 so important? Well, you'll see it here in a minute. But 1988, I came across a sermon, and boy, it scratched up pretty good, had marks all over it, and it was Jesus is coming soon. It had this scripture, Matthew 24, verse 27, 36 through 44. And I went through several more, and I kept coming back. I lay them aside. And I kept coming back to that one. I knew the Lord wanted me to preach on that. Why on this February? Why right now preachers preach on so many different things and stuff? Maybe I should be preaching a little series on love leading up to Valentine. Maybe I should be in there, but no, Jesus is coming. And I stopped right there on that one. I got it out and had to do some revision, of course, and work on it to get it back. This is just a simple sermon about Jesus is coming. Not nothing great that's has some kind of great theological design to it, but just a simple sermon about his return. And basically, we must be ready. There's two R's. We must not only be ready, but we need to be revived. Yes. And maybe there's a third R. We need to rejoice.
Yes.
We need to be ready. We need to be revived. We need to rejoice over his coming, that he's coming again. Well, here's the scripture. Matthew 24, verse 27. For as the lightning cometh out of the east and shineth even unto the west. Now, that there's no coincidence. This past, just a week ago, the weatherman came on and said a phenomenon has happened. One of the longest lightning strikes that's ever been recorded happened here in the United States. And it crossed hundreds and hundreds of miles across the sky. And they said it was the longest one ever recorded, that a strike would go hundreds of miles. And I can't remember, I tell you, how many miles it was. But it was hundreds of miles across several states that this lightning strike was seen running. And Jesus says here, as far as the lightning coming from the east all the way into the west, so shall also the coming of the Son of Man be. Then you drop down to verse 36. Jesus is still talking. But of that day and hour knoweth no man, no, not even the angels of heaven, but my Father only. Now that's simple. When you get asking people, who knows when Jesus is coming? Jesus just said it. Jesus said, I don't know when I'm coming. Jesus said, the angels don't know when I'm coming. coming, but he said, the Father knows when I'm coming. But as the days of Noah were, so shall also the coming of the Son of Man be. For as in the days that were before the flood, they were eating and drinking, marrying and giving in marriage until the day that Noah entered unto the ark, and knew not until the flood came and took them all away, so shall also the coming of the Son of Man be. Then shall two be in the field, and one shall be taken, and one be left. Two women shall be grinding at the mill, one shall be taken, one shall be left. Watch therefore, for you know not what hour your Lord doth come. Now there's another simple, significant thing. Only the Father knows, and only the Father knows the time. Nobody knows the time. So quit that. Quit this trying to find some theological perspective on guessing when Jesus is coming. We don't know. No one knows. So why would I want to waste any of my breath, my energy, and my time? Why do I need to research the scriptures to try to figure out when Jesus is coming when plainly he says that no man knows the hour? And that means I don't know the hour. So I'm not going to search for, I can do other sermons a lot better than I can sit and waste my research on worrying about when Jesus is coming, when he says only the Father knows and nobody else knows, and the time nobody knows. So why would we do that? But you have the knuckleheads out there, and you have the knucklehead followers who will follow those idiots. And they're wanting to project some kind of time that Jesus is coming, and the followers get all excited and they go crazy, and they want to spend all their time thinking and energy on that when people are dying and going to hell. Why are we wasting our time on worrying about when Jesus is coming? Just get to the business. Okay. Watch therefore, for you know not what hour your Lord doth come. Another thing there, very simple. We should be alert to it. But know this, that if the good man of the house had known in what watch the thief would come, he would have watched and would not have suffered his house to be broken up. Therefore be you also ready, for in such an hour as you think not. Another simple thing. Even if we thought we knew the hour, and even if we had it down to a science, we've got her pretty close now, preacher. Look at all the signs. Signs are all lining up. We got her down pretty good. He still says, even as much as you might think, for in such an hour as you think not, the Son of Man cometh. Well, we got to be ready. Every morning this old preacher would randomly open his Bible and take the first verse of scripture that he turned to, and that became his guidance for the day. One morning he broke open his Bible and came to this verse, Judas went out and hung himself. Well, he looked at that and he thought, well, that's not too applicable for my day. Not too suitable. He shut the Bible, he opened it up again, and he came to this verse, go out and do likewise. Well, he still was a little irritated, and he thought, well, I'm gonna open it one more time, three times the charm. He made the last feeble attempt, opened the scripture, and it said, that thou doest, do it quickly. Well, salvation in Christ is needed throughout our world. In regards to Jesus' return, what we do, we need to do it quickly. We got to do it quickly. We just sang that song, Jesus is coming soon. He's coming soon. That's exactly what we will be doing this morning. We know not the hour the Son of Man cometh. It could be within this hour that we're together. I didn't have enough time to surprise you this morning, but I was going to play a little prank on you, and I didn't get up to the booth to do it. I was going to tell how Aaron, when I got to a certain place in Scripture, to blow the trumpet. I didn't do it. But guess what happened to us? Wednesday night, some of you were here Wednesday night. And Wednesday night, I was making the announcement. It didn't come at any other time. It didn't come in our study about Joseph, did it? It didn't come while we were doing prayer requests. It came when I mentioned Sunday, Shorty, is this right? Sunday, I'm going to be speaking on the second coming of Christ, and all of a sudden the sound system let out a big yep. Some kind of big sound, it went off. And they were people, Buck jumped right out of his buckskin. People were on. And it even got me, it drove me for a jolt. I thought, oh, okay, he's coming. Because folks, really, you know the sign that's left? I'll jump ahead a little bit. But you know the only sign that's left? Just the trumpet. We need to hear the trumpet. That all we got left is we hear the trumpet. And it's time. Let us learn from history, from the folks of the Old Testament as they look forward to the Messiah's return. They thought about it. They dreamed about it. They talked about it. But the years went by and he did not come. From the very time that Jesus was born till he went away, they began looking. They began thinking about him coming. The Apostle Paul, he preached early in his ministry. He just couldn't get over the fact that Jesus was going to come while he was still alive. I guess he was disappointed that Jesus didn't come while he was still alive, but he preached a whole lot about it. He was concerned about it, that Jesus will probably be coming very quickly. He'll be coming soon, and he didn't. The Apostle John, he didn't worry so much about it. The Apostle John just come to this sweet conclusion as he was sitting there one day under that palm tree. He was sitting there thinking about, debating about the Lord's return, and he just come to this conclusion. Just even so, come Lord Jesus. Just even so, come Lord Jesus. There it is. You hear that great trumpet. But the years went by and he did not come. The people gave up all hope. They quit watching for his return. When Jesus finally came, the Bible says that when he finally, you know, came to the earth, when he was born the first time, that they didn't recognize him. They didn't know it. They said that even later in his ministry, John 1:11 says he came to his own, and his own knew him not. So as we think about this scripture, there are some things I want you to see. There is the great truth of his coming. Biblical writers have been telling of his coming ever since his ascension back into heaven. Ever since Jesus left us, writers have been writing down and thinking about his return. Most folks today, including many Christians, are not watching for his return. Many have come to the conclusion and attitude, well, he's not coming. You know that you could be in that place, that you are living your life like Jesus is not coming. You know why I say that? Because you need to go back and re-examine your life. Because if you really believe that Jesus could come at any moment, I believe every one of us, including myself, would change some things in our lives. I really believe we would. I think I would adjust some of my priorities. I think there would be things in my life that would be much more important to me than they are right now. If I truly believe what I just said, that Jesus is coming soon. See, we are people today who have just about forgot about his coming again, and we are living our lives at a fast pace, in a fast-paced world, with everything else on our minds except the fact that Jesus could come at this very moment, or Jesus could come today. Now look at some of the facts in Scripture. Look back at the upper room. Jesus told his disciples that he was going to die. Jesus was getting ready to leave them. And here's what he said to them in John 14. He said, "Let not your hearts be troubled." Why did he say that? Because their hearts were troubled. He just said, "I'm leaving. I'm dying. I'm going to go." He comforts them with these words, "Let not your hearts be troubled. You believe in God, believe also in me. In my Father's house are many mansions. If it were not so, I would have told you. I go to prepare a place for you. And if I go and prepare a place for you, I will come again and receive you unto myself, that where I am, there you may be also." Well, there's always a knucklehead in the group. You can't have a Baptist meeting without a knucklehead. It ain't going to happen. You can't have a Baptist meeting without a Methodist being in the bunch. So, no, I didn't mean that. I didn't mean that. Thomas was in the group. And Thomas didn't really believe, did he? We refer to him as Doubting Thomas because, well, Thomas walked with Jesus. He was the disciple. Should he really believe? And yes, he should have. But just because you say you're a Christian and you go to church and you walk with Christ doesn't mean everything's right. And Thomas said, well, Master, how? How do we know this? How do we know the way? You remember in verse 6, Jesus replied, I am the way, the truth, and the life, and no one cometh to the Father except by me. I'm the only way. So look at the facts. Jesus said, I'm going away, but I'm coming back. First thing he did, before he ever left, he said, yes, I'm going away, but I'm coming back. He gives us great assurance. He gives us peace. He gives us comfort. Yes, I'm leaving you, but I'm coming back. What great peace we witnessed this past week with Miss Rosalie. You'll hear more about it tomorrow. But what great peace she gave her family. She said, I'm leaving. She said, I will be gone by Wednesday. She died Tuesday night. She said, but I want you all, gathered all the family around. I was there. Gathered all the family around. And she gave them good preaching. She said, there's some of you that are not saved. There's some of you that are not ready. She said, I'm leaving. I'm going. And I'm going soon. And she said, if you don't know Jesus, you'll never see me again. You'll never see me again. But for you that know the Lord, and if you'll accept the Lord, I'm going to promise you, you'll see me again. Well, Jesus said, be ready. He said, I'm going away, but you're going to get to see me again. I like that when somebody goes away. I love that when I tell my wife, every time I leave, you know, we have that time we leave. We have to part. Well, we do that a lot. And we have to part. And I don't want it to be sad. I hate for it to be sad. I get to the airport. She dropped me off at the airport. And boy, you're standing there and you got to walk away. So we try to not do this real tearful thing all the time. And sitting there, you know, doing all that stuff. And so we try to keep it as light as possible. And so usually we say, if I know I'm going to be back in a month or whatever, I said, I'll see you in about 30 days. I'll see you in 60 days. I will see you again. And that lightens the mood. I will see you again. Well, that lightens the mood. Jesus gives us comfort. He said, I'll see you again. What about the Mount of Olives? Just a couple examples. Jesus is saying his final goodbyes when suddenly a cloud comes down, surrounds him, and then takes him up into heaven. The disciples stand there amazed and stunned. They don't know what to do. When suddenly there is two men in white robes that appear. An angel of the Lord says, you men of Galilee, you know this scripture, why stand you gazing into heaven? This same Jesus which is taken up from you into heaven? Shall so come in like manner as you have seen him go into heaven. Acts chapter 1, verse 11. He's coming back. Why are you standing there? Their mouths were wide open. They were standing there. They were stunned. Uh-oh, they're coming for him. They're coming for him. Oh, no. I guess it's true. He's leaving. And they were stunned and they were amazed. And the angel said, why are you standing here like that with your mouths? If the angel would have said a little more, probably said, why are you standing here with that dumb grin on your face? Why are you standing here, your mouths wide open catching flies? Why are you standing here doing that when he said he's going away, but he will be back again? Some religions believe that Jesus comes in spirit only. And comes when a believer dies. Now he does send his death angel after our souls. I believe that. I believe there's an angel that comes down and gets us. Somebody that Jesus sends to reclaim that soul. But this is not the second coming. This is not Jesus' second coming. Not what he's talking about. When Jesus comes for you in death, that's not it. The dead in Christ rise first, and then he will rapture the saints who remain. 1 Thessalonians 4:16. The truth and facts of his return is this. Here, listen to this. He will come in the air. His feet will not touch the earth. He will come in the air, his feet, and it won't be a spirit. It'll be actually him. He will come in the air. He will take up all believers dead first in Christ. Those who have died in Christ. The Bible says there that nobody shall prevent those that have died in Christ from going. Their souls will go up. Their bodies done gone. Or their bodies left, their souls done gone. So he'll come and reclaim the body, reunite it with the soul. They will be in heaven for 7 years. Tribulation will take place here on earth. Christ will return with all his saints. This ain't it yet. This is the rapture I'm talking about. Christ will return then with all his saints. He will usher in his 1,000-year reign. And Satan will be ultimately defeated. Now you think about how bad things get. People like to say. People like to say, we're living in some terrible time. Yes, we are. But it ain't tribulation yet. Folks, I'm telling you, this is just the tip of the iceberg. This ain't as bad as it can get. Now let me ask you just a simple question. It's so simple. See, everything's simple. There's nothing hard about it. People make it hard because you want to think too much. Oh, 7 years. Oh, no, preacher, what did he do? Oh, preacher just said something there. It's blowing my mind. Because he said, oh, no, he got it out of order. I'm sure he did. Why are we concerned about that crazy stuff? He's coming. He's going to reign. But think about this, how simple it is. If you think it's bad, how bad would this world be without Christians? Think about that just a moment. Think about it just a moment. It's a bad world we live in. Yes, it is. Even with us here, it's bad. But you think what's going to happen when Jesus takes all the believers, when he raptures all the saints, then you're going to have some hell on earth. Then you're going to have some tribulation. Then you're going to have something. I mean, there's no Christians. There's no barriers. There's no protection. Folks, listen to me. We are the only thing that stands between people and hell. Did you hear that? You are the only thing as a believer that stands between your family, your loved ones, your friends, your co-workers, your schoolmates. You as a Christian are the only one who stands between them and hell. If they don't know Christ. And you take that block out. You take that blocker out. You imagine there's nothing left. Nothing left. No encouragement. And whatever's left will be false teaching, right? Whatever's left will be baloney. Well, that's the truth. The time of his coming, well, we done established that. All the false reports, oh my goodness. Let me give you just a few. We got time. Edgar C. Wisnot wrote in his book, This is the Reason, in 1988. 88 reasons why the rapture could be in 1988. I read the book. 88 reasons why the rapture would be in 1988. Well, I remember that on, and guess what the date was? September the 11th. Ooh, let's get a little scary here. Ooh. September the 11th. This was before 9/11 of 01. September 11, 1988. Jesus is going to return. 88 reasons he gave in his book why that Jesus would return. Well, I'm going to tell you what, I remember that day very well. I didn't lose no family. I didn't lose no friends. Nobody vanished before my sight. Jesus didn't come. Judge Joseph Franklin Rutherford, founder of the Jehovah's Witness cult, said, quote, You can back it up. Jesus will definitely come sometime in 1914. 1914, I took a little trip.
On the Mississippi.
On the Mississippi or something other. 1914, well, Jesus did not come. So later, the judge, they called him. I don't know if he ever was a judge. But Judge Rutherford said, he changed his revised statement. Jesus' coming was only spiritual and no one saw it. I guess he didn't miss anybody either, including himself. The Bible says, "Behold, he cometh with the clouds, and every eye shall behold him." When he comes, everybody's going to know it. When he comes, everybody's going to see it. He's not coming spiritually, folks. He's coming as a mighty warrior of God. And his sword is real. Seventh-day Adventist, might be a few of you in the bunch, reported that Jesus would come in 1844. Many prepared by selling everything they had. They put on their white robes. They went out to some mountaintops in Colorado. They had a long wait. Some even died, for Jesus didn't show up. Here's what Jesus says, the supreme authority. I read it to you, verse 36. "But of that day and hour knoweth no man, no, not the angels of heaven, but my Father only." Only my Father knows. So all those people who have predicted Jesus would come, they have wasted the ink on the paper. That was crazy. But there was people who followed him. See, a lot of people would rather believe books and believe writers and believe so-called prophets than to believe the actual Word of God. When you got the actual Word of God, it's written in red. Anybody know what written in red means? Jesus said it. And when Jesus says it, that draws my attention. All I can tell you is soon and very soon, we're going to see the King. The signs of the times. What are they, preacher? Increase in world crime. Change of the seasons. Disrespect of authority. Haven't we just went through that? From your father and mother to police officers and anybody else in authority. One world currency. We're just about there. One world currency. We're basically, I think we are there. Because when I went to Israel, when I went to Japan, when I went to Mexico, when I go to Canada, when I go anywhere, well, even when I go down to Publix here in Florida, I carry in my billfold a little card. And that is the most magical card I've ever come across. I simply went to the bank, I deal with Mid-Florida, and they'll print you one right on the spot. I don't have to wait 10 days to get it or 2 weeks, but I went in there, I opened me an account. I have all my money put into that account. I don't even need to see the money. It just goes right into the account. I put it in there, take the check. There it goes. If we had direct deposit, I wouldn't even see it at all. But I do like holding the check for about 2 minutes. What that does, it kind of does something to me. I hold it, okay. Now I got to give it up. But anyhow, I put that money in that account. As long as I keep doing that, I never see a Ben Franklin, George Washington. I never see one of them. And all I've got to do is take that little magical card that's in my back pocket. And it's got a chip in it. And I just take that thing, and you know what you can do now? My son told me up here. I think he did it. You can take and just hold it up to something. Tap it. I ain't got that brave yet. I still insert it. Not got that brave to just tap it. But boy, you just tap it. And now you don't even have to do that. You know, you can just get on your phone. Anybody with me? All dummies in the audience? Just your phone, PayPal, pay him, pay her, whatever it's called. And you just hit it, and it's done. I think we're pretty close to one world currency, aren't we?
Yeah.
Matter of fact, when I went to Israel, they said, do not bring cash. You need to go get you an American Express. We don't take Visa. And I went and got me an American Express gold card. And when I went to Israel, buddy, everybody took it. The guy at the fish market took it. Everybody liked that American Express. So you don't need cash. One world government, pretty much there. One world currency, pretty much there. East preparing to take over the world, pretty much right there. The nation of Israel, all that's went on, boy, we've done been there. When you see these signs come to pass, these things, Luke said, know ye that the kingdom of God is at hand. Folks, it'll be a glorious day when he comes. A glorious day for us as believers. But let me leave you on these notes. A great time of sorrow and suffering for the non-believer. Let's just say that what I've said is not true for a minute. Let's just ponder that. Some of you don't believe in him. But let's just ponder the fact that what I've already said is not true. Okay. What if I'm wrong? What if you're wrong? What if the world is right? Let me ask you something. What have I lost in believing? Have I lost anything? Have I lost anything in believing in a wonderful Savior who loved the world, and God is love, and God offers forgiveness, and God is mercy, and God is grace, and God loves his children, and God calls us, and God wants to save us and keep us, and God wants to protect us, and God is with me, and I can pray to him, and I feel good when I pray to him, and I believe he answers my prayers, and he does, and I have all that going for me? What have I lost by believing in Jesus Christ? I have lost nothing.
Amen.
But to the person who does not believe, what if I'm right? You've lost everything.
Right.
You've lost everything. Because hell is just as real as heaven. If you believe in heaven, you'd better believe in hell. Matter of fact, the Bible talks more about hell than it does heaven. There's a reason for that, folks. Because we shouldn't be going around all the time just giving the sweet, sweet sound of music. And talking about harps. And singing and dancing, not the Baptist, but singing and dancing in heaven. When there is a heaven to gain, but a hell to shun. If you follow the Apostle Paul, he preached a great deal about avoiding a place called hell. About living your life faithfully. Well, it's all about what we think. Your business work is over. The deal's plans are finished. Your witness wisdom is gone. Family and friendships no more. Your planning preparation is now, now or never. Your destination is sealed when Jesus comes. Sealed. And you may think you're right by not believing. Well, Ben Franklin, 1784, Ben Franklin thought he was right. Ben Franklin wrote a letter, expressed his unhappiness to his daughter over the choice of the eagle as a symbol for America. He was not happy that they had picked the eagle. He wanted his preference of a turkey to be America's symbol of freedom. Even though we act like it and we think like it sometimes, we're definitely not turkeys. I like the eagle myself, don't you? I like that eagle. As a sign of freedom. I know we do not have a lot of folks in our country that, you know, that the turkey may emblem, it might fit that, or, you know, maybe not us, but the majority of the folks would rather be like an eagle, like Isaiah talked about, soaring like the eagle. It's important that we believe Jesus is coming, and Jesus is coming quickly. You guys come. As we prepare for invitation, let me finish with a true story. I got looking, and I've preached on Jesus coming, and I probably have here, but this particular sermon version I haven't preached, as far as I know, since then. And I remember preaching that sermon. I remember where I was at. I was at Red Hill Baptist Church, my first church, Hazard, Kentucky, the mountains of eastern Kentucky. Church had grown by then. I went there in 1982. We had four people. Counting me and my wife, the missionary and his wife, there were eight there that day that I preached my trial sermon. Eight people. We brought half of them. Wasn't much of a risk calling an old green boy just out of school. Wasn't much of a risk calling to a little church that had four people. He couldn't hurt it, could he? Wasn't much he could do to it. So I preached a trial sermon, and they accepted me as their pastor. And Melissa and I, we went there. We commuted for a few years from London across, 75 miles one way, back and forth. Well, by 1988, the church had really grown. We were running more than we have here on a Sunday a lot of times. We'd have 150, 180 in service. I remember preaching, Jesus is coming soon. A little lady came down the aisle, one of our faithful ladies. She'd be just as faithful as Miss Rosalie. She'd be just as faithful as any of you dear sweet ladies. She came down the aisle. She was troubled. She said, "Preacher, I'm afraid." And I said, "Why are you afraid?" She said, "I'm afraid Jesus coming, what you preach, I'm afraid of it." I said, "Why are you afraid of it?" I said, "You're one of the most dedicated, faithful people that I know. Why would you be afraid of it?" I'll never forget what she said. I said, "I know you're ready. You're ready to meet the Lord." She said, "Preacher, I'm ready. But I got a husband at home, and I got two wayward children that are not ready. And I would rather Jesus not come right now, preacher." I'll never forget that. So we prayed diligently and we prayed hard. I said, "I'll make a covenant with you. We'll pray every single day for your husband and your two sons. Every single day. I'll have the deacons. They will pray." I said, "We got a revival coming up. We're going to mention, can I mention their names? I'm going to mention their names to the prayer group." We prayed for them. Her husband got saved. Eventually, her two sons got saved. They started coming with their wives, and they got saved. She said, "Well, preacher, I guess there's no excuse now. I'm ready." Folks, ready or not, Jesus is coming.
Right.
But make sure you got your household tucked in, because that means a difference. It means a difference today. Father, thank you for the hour. Thank you for the time together. Father, please take, Father, our request right now, Lord, that we would all be ready. May we be able to say it. May those words come from our tongues, fall off our lips today as we're praying. Lord, I'm ready. Lord, I'm ready. I'm ready. Father, I know we have loved ones. I know we have friends. Maybe even some right here in the service today, that their wives or their husbands or their parents are concerned about them because, Lord, they're not ready. Lord, I pray we get ready today. Accept Jesus as our Savior. Trust what He's done for us. And look forward to His return. In In Jesus' name, amen.
We invite you to stand as we sing, Turn Your Eyes Upon Jesus. Christ's holy and precious name. Amen.